acquire users. Very relevant subject for a lot of people who have mobile apps. And both Phil and I have been in the games industry for many years. So our customers tend to be game developers. But a lot of the same best practices and the tactics for user acquisition really apply across different genres of apps. Okay. So before we get started, how many of you have a mobile app? So that should be relevant for lots of you.
Are some of you guys about to launch a mobile app? Like,
okay.
Great. Okay. So, and the reason, you know, gaming's pioneered a lot of the business models a few years ago that are kind of prevalent right now. We're going to talk to a lot of those kind of business models. So we're not covering every kind of business model out there. There are things that would be different for an app that has, say, you know, a paid app or has monthly, you know, maybe a monthly subscription fee. So please keep that in mind. And we can talk more about kind of the off cases after.
And it's okay to interrupt.
Yes.
Let's have a conversation format. So we'll just, obviously we have 20 minutes, so we're just gonna go running across all the subjects. But if something's particularly interesting or relevant for any of you, just do not hesitate to interrupt. So okay, is that the first one?
Yeah.
So we'll cover launch strategy, then some of the launch tactics, and the best practices for measuring and optimizing. Okay, so you got an app. What to do next? The mobile ecosystem is a complete mess. There are all these networks and providers and all this three-letter abbreviation, RTB and DSP and CPC, CPM, CPA. So where should a developer start? How to find a partner for mobile acquisition? Where to spend your money? How to bid? And what type of media should you use? You know, video, interactive display ads. So many, many options. So a good place to start is actually have a plan. Is to develop a strategy. And your marketing strategy for launching or acquiring users for mobile app should have three things. It should really hone down on acquiring organic users through viral channels and basically develop tactics for that. B, it should really utilize very efficient channels and tactics for paid user acquisition so you don't waste your money. And number three, it should rely on so-called mobile best practices, which we'll go over. To measure and analyze what's happening with your mobile marketing. So really, I'm going to turn it over to Phil in a second. But I just want to say that we see it over and over again that mobile developers who are just about to launch don't really know what to do, and they have, you know, maybe they're funded and they have the budget, so they just give their money to an agency or an ad network and say, well, okay, this is $50,000 or $100,000. Let's do it. This is such a bad strategy. We're an agency, but we, the first lesson is to say, don't do that. Don't give your money to one provider or an agency without having a consistent plan and actually knowing how to do this growth hacking yourself. And why should you do it? It's because a lot of agencies are just happy to, they are biased towards spending your money versus your goals are to acquire, not to spend your money, but to acquire as many users as possible for free. And good users too, who actually come back and engage with your app versus just spending your marketing budget. So,
stay here for a second.
Okay.
So we've done this for a while, and we've kind of engaged in a lot of different tactics and strategies, and consistently, actually, where we focused our services are where we've seen the highest ROI. So, I mean, there's a lot of things you could do, right? You could PR, and you can do viral, app store optimization, paid, and there are many things beyond that. Consistently, what we've seen is App Store optimization is a good place to spend your time. We'll show you a little bit of why. Viral channels for most apps, if there's a viral factor, are really important. And paid acquisition, you know, if your app kind of fits the model, is very important.
Not properly.
You can do things like PR and, you know, spend money on PR agencies or do it yourself. There are reasons to do it, but they haven't led to direct ROI results in the kind of space we've been in. So we don't focus on it. That's not to say you shouldn't pay attention to it, but just be careful, like, throwing a lot of money at doing media outreach. So I kind of don't like the term growth hacking, but I kind of see why it came about, because a lot of the marketing that goes on is like advertising, basically, where you're trying to get ROI and not maximizing your growth. So this is off the screen. All right, so what's the difference between if you're just spending money to try to get users versus optimizing your organic growth? You know, so this is like the kind of example that you get. If you you know, we could show you the logic behind this, but if you just spend money and get users, you get a certain number of users. If you get 50%, if you get 50% extra boost on top of every user because your discovery and your virality is optimized, that you're on a whole different trajectory that basically compounds itself.
Because free users are also more engaged users, and when you have virality and organic growth, you get better engagement with your app, better sharing, better metrics, and better monetization if you're monetizing your app.
Right. If somebody's looking for you and they find you, they're more likely to be a good user than somebody you flashed an ad in front of and is like, oh, I guess
I'll
that's
try it out.
Yeah. So that's kind of the idea there. So that's just kind of a note about traditional ad agencies that, you know, when we talk about, here's $100, get me some users. The problem is, like, that traditional ad agency model is getting a percent of your media dollars. So your goals kind of become misaligned with those kind of companies. They want to spend as much money as possible to get users. Your success relies on as many free and organic users as possible. So that's why we're kind of, you know, careful with that model of, like, buy me users for this amount of money.
Okay. I'll take this over again for a second. It's okay, so it starts with a plan. So we're just gonna give you, like, sort of the, we call it mobile launch package, like a checklist. So all the things you have to, ducks in a row you have to get before you launch. So the first place to start for every developer, and it's surprising like how many people don't do it, it just blows my mind, is actually have a plan, have goals. So you sit down with your marketing team, with your VCs, I don't know, with your executive team, and you identify what kind of goals you know. It's not just get users. The goals have to be like, what do you want to be in the charts? What do you want to be in a specific category where your app is? How much can you afford to spend on a user? What kind of monetization model do you have? Are you making money? Do you have lifetime value of a user benchmark? Is it maybe, you know, how well you will be monetizing? Or if you can afford losing money on user acquisition, then what's your most tolerable margin is? How much money you can afford, you know, losing per user? So you have to like really understand your metrics. And then you have to also define what exactly you're looking for. If you're what's your key metrics for success? So KPIs, key performance indicators, you know, engagement, monetization, LTV, lifetime value per user. So I'm sure all of you have a business plan, and all of you like have these metrics, what you're looking for. It's really important to make sure it's part of your user acquisition plan to actually have that in line. Because then you'll be able to sell how well you're doing. Are you failing? Are you succeeding? But before you have benchmarks, unless you have benchmarks, you really don't know how well you're doing. Also, your metrics and your KPI benchmarks can depend upon where your app is in the life cycle. Because when you're just launching, typically we see betas going for 2-3 months. This is when you're optimizing your product and the features of the product. So from the marketing perspective, in that stage, it makes sense to acquire the best users you can on one platform in one geography. And like for games, we usually test in Canada, New Zealand, and Australia, so that you don't want to like test in the US, or just limited launch in the US. Because these geographies are the geographies where users are typically the most engaged, monetize the best. So actually, if you're acquiring the right kind of users within certain demographics profiling, then you know that if the app is not performing well, if the users are not coming back, the metrics are not there, it's not because your marketing sucks. It's because something needs to be adjusted to the product. So after the app comes out of beta, then your marketing goals change. Then you're trying to acquire, well, still good users, but maybe you can acquire less quality of users, but in a high amount because you're trying to get high up the charts and maximize your virality. And then, you know, you're not really like so strict about this particular quality. Does it make sense? So far? Questions? No questions. Okay, so we talked about setting goals and having a budget and really,
Does any of these things really differ if you're doing like iOS first or Android first?
Well, you still have to have a plan and you still have to have cap. Something will differ, and actually, I'm going to turn it over to Phil when we talked about App Store optimization and search optimization, the viral channels.
Your tactics will
this
vary.
Vary there between iOS and Android, and he'll actually cover that. But in terms of having a plan, it doesn't matter where you're launching. Actually, even if you're launching not a mobile app, but to launch on Facebook or something, you still have to have like plans and KPIs and analytics, right? So yeah, that doesn't change.
But the answer is the tactics change. App Store optimization on Google looks different than on Apple, but generally your KPIs are your KPIs no matter what platform you're on.
Yeah, and also it also changes in a part where you are acquiring paid users, and there's such thing as, you know, incentivized downloads on iOS, and you might want to use them during your burst campaign when you're going up the charts, because, you know, the algorithm of Apple allows it. We actually caution people from doing that. But on Android, this tactic doesn't work, because Android algorithm, charting algorithm, takes into consideration your engagement, quality of users. So some tactics change, but. Okay, so, and then before you launch the marketing campaigns, you have to do, this is a very like busy slide, sorry about that, but it's the last busy slide.
Like, I debated not putting in this kind of really basic marketing stuff about targeting and demographics, but like consistently we see people that get this in their business plans but then kind of throw it out of the window when they go for their mobile acquisition. So, you know, and I think the background of mobile is a lot of the early mobile marketing you did didn't even allow for targeting. Like, Facebook's brought in real targeting based on all these things. So people stop thinking in terms of like basic marketing. So before you go in, like, you really have to talk to whoever's going to do your, you know, whether it's internal marketing or your agency, about who the right users are. You know, what are their interests? I mean, there's very like superficial stuff like their demographics and that kind of stuff. But now that we have Facebook and we know what people are doing and what they're interested in, like, really take time to think about it and make it as specific to your product as possible.
Because you can find them.
Yeah, like if you know that you have this weird correlation between what you're doing and the same people like cooking apps, you know, or something, you can now have that kind of targeting. So the more insight you have into your users, the more it actually goes into your action plan. So just have it and know it and talk about it. You know, if you, again, like when you give somebody your money and say, get me users, and you're not talking about geographies, they can do anything. They can go get you a bunch of Indonesian, you know, users. Not that there's anything wrong with Indonesians, but they don't tend to spend money in apps like Americans do. You know, so you have to be very specific about that kind of stuff. Messaging is very, very important. This kind of performance marketing is very action-centric. We do testing across like hundreds of thousands of different messages for a particular app, and we see that, you know, hey, it might be a giant image with a small message, but that
and
message.
And sometimes capital letters in words like make a difference on a conversion. It's really crazy. It's like, you know, actually, it is one of the best practices is to have like every word capitalized, for example. A font makes a difference.
Yeah.
A
so
position
A/B test is basically the deal. Yeah. But you start out with your messaging. So you have to understand basically what you want to say. You limit it to some set of messages, and then you go out and you test. So there is this tendency now that you can test a bunch of stuff to kind of make it up on the fly and see what works. That's usually not a good idea for starters.
Let me actually tell you guys how to test that. Because we say test, but you know, the easiest way to test messaging and creative is actually do a tiny test on Facebook. You spend like, you have like a couple of, well, several images with different body and messaging, and you just spend like $50 on each, or like 20, because you don't really pay unless you get clicks on install, right?
Yeah.
And then you just see which one converts better, and then you're like, oh, well, that's the direction I should take.
Okay.
Maybe it's like pink grandma, I don't know, something.
Right. And finally, copy. So the copy in your app, it has an even greater weight than it would in typical ad copy. So typical ad copy is very consumer-centric. Now that we're dealing with algorithms and search and all this stuff, the stuff in your description is actually, a lot of it is geared towards the search engines that guide what people find. Particularly important with Google, like, people might read the first paragraph of what you write in Google Play, but Google catalogs everything. And so when you're doing this kind of stuff, when you're writing your copy, you really have to think of it more from an App Store optimization perspective than from a consumer perspective, which is a little bit of change of thinking. It's very, like, App Store optimization as a whole, like, we can do hours on just that, but Google and Apple are very different in the way they do search, and so, like, your copy description, for example, in Google, all of that gets categorized. Apple ignores the whole thing and just looks at your keywords. So there's very specific things you have to know about App Store optimization.
But Google finds your iOS app copy, so you want to optimize sometimes on iOS so that Google can find it.
Right, on the web.
On the web. So
yeah. So there's
and there are lots of tools actually that allow you, help you do that. We can't, maybe during like dinner we can answer the questions, but yeah, it's a worthwhile exploration if somebody's launching to look into that.
So when you when you're in this world of app marketing, like everything feels like it's about paid acquisition and you know spending money to get users. When in reality, if you look across the app store, this is a little bit of an old graphic, but nothing's changed really. Is that most users find apps by doing app store search. So you know, and
do you guys see what's below there?
Yeah. So this is searching the app store, and this is like family and friends, and paid acquisition is like
media.
Right there. So it's like anywhere from 10 to 17% of your users, on average, right? For any particular, for some app that has a huge budget, that it might not look like this, but this is the average across the ecosystem. So when we talk about discovery, organic discovery, it is by far the like the greatest source of discovery. So that's why when you do these marketing plans, this has to get a lot of attention.
So what do you go to your desk after that? And if you have like a chat app, like text messaging, you just go like chat up and see number what you come up in the search.
Right.
You come up number 5, number 6, number 20.
Right.
You can influence that.
Right. That's
by
not...
doing these techniques.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that that you know, paid marketing seems to be a low indicator of how likely an app is to be discovered, but you have some quantitative measure of like the function of how much money I throw at app marketing and how often be discovered.
You have to be a little bit careful about this because this is the whole ecosystem. So there's a million apps, right? And most of those app developers don't have money. So this gets skewed, right? So an app that has $1 million to spend, like their chart won't look like this at all. Like 75% of their downloads might come from paid.
You know, we work with games. It's different. There are like viral games and non-viral games, like a bingo games, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Huge budgets. They spend spend lots of money. Over 65% of downloads are viral. It's for real. Some games are less viral, like 70% of downloads are paid. So it depends, and you know, we suspect like it's also for the apps the same way. It's a social app, it's less social app.
Right.
So the factor of virality is differs,
right.
But it's something you can influence.
But to the point, when you're planning your budget, you should have some idea of how that mix is going to look like and have a target plan. Like, if your app is highly social, right, if you need other people to do it with you, then it should really be driving a lot of that. And your paid acquisition is just starting, like it gets you up that curve, and then at some point virality has to take over. If you have an app that monetizes highly and is like people do it alone, you know, you have apps like that, then like more of it will be through paid.
And that's what you optimize your data too. You start. Sorry, I'm interrupting.
No, I just want to make sure we answer questions.
Yeah, well, go ahead.
Yeah, lots of.
So, yeah. Can I ask a follow up?
Yeah.
What you're saying is the iTunes algorithm. Likes to push down paid apps and likes to push up paid apps.
I don't know that that's true.
I think it's true.
In search ranking.
I mean, we did a whole post about it actually on our blog, so you can read about it. I don't think that's actually the way the algorithm works. But I think what it does do is it's indirectly this happens because A, download volume matters, and free apps have more of it, and reviews matter, and actually, paid apps get better reviews on average, interestingly enough. So there are other factors that I think make that happen. I hear developers complain all the time, like, oh, the algorithm favors free apps. Probably if somebody has a paid app and somebody has a free app, and downloads is like one of the top things, indicators of this is a popular app, it's going to give way to that free app. That's just the reality.
So if I have a paid app and I feel like I'm at a disadvantage in the iTunes ranking, what do I do?
Get a free app. That has a limited functionality and links to your paid app. I mean, that's the simplest answer, right?
Yeah.
So this is first order app discovery. What about second order? As in, like, you pay for the acquisition, and that person then tells their friends. Type
oh,
right.
Yeah,
so family and friend is really big, right?
No. So what is the, like, if you pay for one user and then they tell their friends, how does that factor?
So that's what we were talking about. The whole viral factor. So this does so.
Friends and family.
Friends and family. This is the second chart. The second thing that is the secondary. So.
But it's also called K factor, so to say, like you know your virality factor.
Uh-huh.
It's really difficult to capture actually and reflect in this graph specifically because nobody really knows unless you're really capable of measuring as your own app.
Right.
The ecosystem can't pick up where that organic users came from.
Just picks it up as organic. No, let me just talk to this graph. Because this graph, the way this was done, I know how this was done in particular, they surveyed a bunch of people and said, how do you decide what apps you download? And this is what came up. So what you're talking about is when you buy a download and somebody, and there's like a viral download that happens after that, that's the family and friend, the second bar. So people are saying, yeah, like 50 to 60% of the time, the reason I download something is because somebody else, I discovered it through somebody else. So it plays a huge factor in the overall ecosystem. I'll get to it. Just on this point about algorithms, this is our website, and one of the recent things they did, I started to get into this whole app store optimization thing, and we don't really have time for it, so this chart is there too, but this whole thing, this is what parameters are used in app store algorithms, and this talks about, like, so just, like, if you want a lot more about this, either talk to us about it, or go to the blog, and we'll talk about it. It's a deep topic that is...
Yeah, but we can touch a little bit about traffic sources. You mean like as a paid acquisition?
Yeah, you guys earlier discussed it's important. You know,
yeah. So we haven't gotten there yet. We're stuck on ASL.
Yeah, we're stuck on non-paid. Yeah. The problem is deep kind of conversation. Like, I'll give you one quick one. Whatever you're doing, start with Facebook. You know, like, it's pretty much... Because of their demographic targeting and their huge network, like any plan, almost a paid acquisition plan, always starts.
So during beta, Facebook.
Yeah, just.
After beta, when you have to, and this is actually an acquisition plan, projections by platform.
Yeah.
So after you're out of beta, when you need to actually do worldwide launch, you have to rely on several sources. And then, you know, frankly, it doesn't matter which sources they are. We can't like give you the list of priorities because for every app, they're different. But basically, what's important is to have this, like our next section address that the best practices, the measuring SDKs in place. Because if you have visibility and, you know, a solution that's one SDK that allows you to integrate several sources, you could have 10, you could have 15, 20 sources.
Right.
You turn them on, you see how they perform, and you turn them off. So that's the best practice. There's no magic bullet of having like three best sources, because for everybody, it's...
So the problem in the mobile ecosystem is that kind of targeting is not always available. We're saying Facebook because Facebook lets you control that. A lot of ad networks kind of put a layer in between you and like the target.
You are lucky if you even have demographic parameters. Like companies like Flurry tells you, oh, there is an interest group targeting. As soon as you need to increase the volume, it goes out of the door.
Right.
You get 10 installs. So it's really difficult to achieve, actually. Same with RTBs. Presumably, the data is profiled, you know, like Twitter acquired MoPub. So you know that from the logic of the acquisition, the day where all this massive data on ad networks will be sort of profiled in some kind of interest and demographic context is coming. That's why they did that. But it's not there yet.
Right.
So outside of Facebook, it's still a dream to be able to target your interest groups.
So that's all to say, we cover it later, but that's all to say that have some hypothesis going in, but have analytics that tell you what the different quality of users are from each source, and just go with what works after that.
And then, speaking of mobile best practices, so this is going to be...
Just before we... Okay. Let's run through the presentation and leave the Q&A for the...
Yeah, okay. This is too thick anyway. So this is in gaming. This is like very important slide. It's like how you measure. The best practice is to have the analytics SDKs and metrics in place. And this is how we measure. We measure acquisition KPIs, retention KPIs, like how many people come back on the second day, within a week, within a month, you know, retention. Average user lifetime, stickiness, how well you convert your, you know, new users into daily users. So measure all that stuff. No time to address it. But hopefully, you're all measuring all this stuff, too. But, you know, what I wanted to go over really quickly, yeah, like engagement ultimately is what drives everything. But what I wanted to go over very quickly is this one slide, last slide, because this is like, brings the point home. So there are solutions. So you have many sources, right? All the said networks. And it's really difficult to try them all. We just said, like, why don't you try 10, 20 sources when you're acquiring at volume? Well, how do you do that? You have to do SDK integration, give them $5,000 or whatever the minimum budget is. It's kind of not that easy to try so many sources. Well, it is if you have right solutions in place. So basically, you need to have a source tracking solution, first and foremost, for marketing. And there are several of them. There's like Apps Flyer and ADX and HasOffers. So there's one solution, HasOffers, that we're using. We recommend it to everyone. It's cheap. It's worth it. You put one SDK. It basically sits, source tracking solution, right? And then instead of integrating all multiple SDKs, it's just really easy integration of new marketing sources. You can basically try them within a minute, you know? And it tells you how you click Converse to install. You have one dashboard, which tells you, okay, this is how many installs and what is the cost I got from all the different sources. So you can basically optimize your campaigns in real time and test your hypothesis. They even can track, if you have a free app, which like monetizes, you know, through market transactions, they can even track that. And within the same dashboard, see like from which source you get better users that actually come back and monetize better. So it's very important to use a solution like that. Otherwise, you're just, you know, throwing blindly money against the wall and don't know what's happening. So, and then have some analytics that tells you what's happening in the app post-install. No time to go over these different solutions, but there are many, many different options, right? There's Contagion, expensive, there's Expano. There's Flurry that's free, and it's not very, you know, it's not very robust, but it's free, you know, why don't at least have that? At least you know how many DAUs, MAUs, and what kind of like session length you have in the app. So at least do Flurry, if nothing else. But yeah, be thoughtful about what analytics you're using. And we are gonna finish here and take questions.
Yeah. Just regarding this slide, are these like specialized solutions, or could you use Google Analytics as well that tune it to like your specific needs?
This is Google Analytics. I haven't seen it a lot in mobile apps, but Google Analytics does work for post-install analytics. I don't think they have much in terms of source tracking, unless you're purely on Android. For Android, they do have source tracking, but iOS not. It gets kind of hairier in iOS.
Since we
kind of
glazed over a couple of things since this presentation,
we can
get our hands on.
I'm sorry. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. What's the best way to send it to you, Mark?
Yes, you can send it to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
We'll start setting up while you guys.
Yeah. We can unplug it.
Okay.
Anything else, guys? We'll be around, so talk to us.